So many books in April, where to even start? This is about to be a whole journey. Let's buckle up and let's talk some books. Hello, book reading friends. Welcome back to my channel, or welcome if you're new. My name is Mel, and today I am here with all the books I read in April, also known as my April wrap-up. Today we're gonna run down and talk about all of the books that I read in the month of April. Physical, audio, everything in between, how I read, when I read it, what I rated it, all of my concise thoughts. So today I'm going to spill the beans into all of the books that I read in the month of April. I believe I read a total of 17 books. That is obviously including graphic novels, but most of them were books in prose, which was quite impressive. I did audiobook several of them. I'm very excited to chat all about all of the books that I read, from books with no rating to 1 stars, 2 stars, 3 stars, 4 stars, and 5 stars. So we are going to have an interesting experience today. And before I start with today's video, I need to give a massive thank you to the sponsor of today's video, Chirp Audiobooks. If you are not familiar with Chirp, Chirp is an audiobook retailer that offers literally amazing limited time audiobook deals. There are hundreds of audiobooks to choose from their selection, and some of them are up to 95% off. And the cool thing about Chirp specifically is that, unlike other audiobook retailers, it is very easy to try out. It is commitment free. It is not set on a monthly fee, so it is not a monthly subscription. You sign up to Chirp and you literally get the audiobook that you want. It is yours to own. You keep it forever. It is in your library. And again, you can get it as little as 95% off, which is amazing, because honestly, audiobooks, they can be quite expensive. As you all know, I have been getting more and more into audiobooks recently, especially since I've been so busy lately with so many responsibilities at once. Audiobooks are a great way to squeeze in reading, whether I'm journaling, whether I am doing computer work, whether I am doing chores around the house, cooking. It is a great form of media to squeeze in reading while still being productive with several things at once. So multitasking at its finest, and even if you're not vibing with the book physically, sometimes the audiobook can enrich the reading experience. As I am checking right now, current deals that they have going on, they currently have Red, White, and Royal Blue by Casey McQuiston for $3.99. You guys know, this was one of my favorite books of last year. I absolutely love Red, White, and Royal Blue. I also recently downloaded Daisy Jones and the Six with the Chirp app, because a lot of you love that audiobook, so I am definitely excited to get into Daisy Jones and the Six, because the audiobook has one of my favorite elements, and that is a full cast of characters. So if you do want to sign up to Chirp, I have a 50% off code for you guys, MelReads50, and you can use the link at the top of my description to just redirect you to Chirp directly. Sign up, get your audiobooks, and literally have the most fun reading these. So yes, thank you so much to Chirp for sponsoring today's video, and without further ado, let's get right into the April wrap-up. Oh boy, okay, I'm checking everything that I read in April, and this is going to be a literal journey. I hope y'all are ready for this. The first book that I have in here is the book that I gave no rating to. The lowest rating that Goodreads allows you to put on something is 1 star. I didn't feel like it was fair to pit this particular book against all of the 1 stars, even, or the 2 stars, or the 3 stars. How do I put this? How do I measure this in a regular scale? And this is Den of Vipers by K.A. Knight. Now, if you guys know, I buddy read this with my friend, with Christine, Jaleesa, Gavin, and Liv, and this was a time, to say the very least. It was a very lengthy book, and it was a mess, honestly. I don't even want to speak too much on Den of Vipers. I do not recommend this book to anyone. I personally don't see the appeal to Den of Vipers. I think it was very disturbing and a little bit concerning how all of these characters were written in a very kind of masochist, no agency, abusive, triggering sort of way. There are a bunch of trigger warnings in here for physical abuse, for emotional abuse, for mutilation, for torture, for substance abuse, for kidnapping, for murder. There's just so many things in here that need to be highlighted when talking about trigger warnings. And I have not seen any of those online. I gave it no rating on Goodreads, but it was a 0 star on my Notion spread. So that was the first book that I started the month out with. I am also going to talk about these two in conjunction. This is Check Please, books 1 and 2 by Ngozi Okazu. Now, I read these one at the beginning of the month and then the other at the end of the month during a 24-hour readathon. Now, in these ones, we follow Eric Biddle, who is a hockey player, and he is accepted to his dream college, Samuel University, and he tries out for the hockey hockey team. He is not your typical hockey player. He is not necessarily as in shape as the other players. He doesn't really represent kind of like the stereotype that you would see from an athlete, if you will. He loves baking, making his pies, his marmalade, everything in between. He loves, you know, bringing housewarming gifts and just being the best host that he can be. And besides that, he has his own vlog going on. The entirety of the series is narrated as if he was talking to you as a viewer, as if you were watching his videos. And I think that was what made these incredibly immersive and interactive as a reader. I found myself constantly rooting for Biddy. And there is a romance in here with Jack, who is the captain of the hockey team, who is older than Biddy. And I really just enjoyed these. The illustrations were absolutely stunning. I gave the first one 4 stars, but then this one just gave me everything that I needed. The dynamic in here with family, with sexuality, with relationships, with friendship was all in book two. And I think that part was fantastic. That was all that I was expecting from book two. Next up, I read The Romance Book Club by Lissa K. Adams. Now, this one I adored with my entire being. We follow Gavin, who is married to Thea, and they've been married for a few years. They have twin daughters, and their marriage is on the brink of divorce after Gavin found out that Thea has been faking the big O for the majority of their relationship. He doesn't really want to accept it. He doesn't really want to move on from his wife, who he still very much adores. And so his friends team up, bring him into the Bromance Book Club, a club that centers around these guys reading romance novels that kind of relate to their relationship status, to their marital relationship struggles. That way they can learn how a woman thinks and hopefully fix what has been wronged in their relationships. So his friends bring him in, teach him all of their ways to, again, hopefully fix something that is seemingly broken. I think what I enjoyed so much about this one in particular was the talk about life after marriage. A lot of books end with the epilogue being marriage and kids and rainbows and smiles and just butterflies and sunshines, and it seems like it's the end all be all, but it's completely untrue. There is so much that goes down after marriage, a lot of struggles, whether that is financial, whether that is having kids, the struggle of having kids, whether that is something in between that kind of comes in between the couple. And I just love the fact that this touches on that subject and the fact that it was still so hopeful and flirty and just sexy, and I loved every second of it. It was really funny. The side characters were hilarious. I literally couldn't stop laughing as I was reading this. Read this in one sitting. I just really am looking forward to continuing on with the series, and so I gave it 4 stars. Oh my god, this month I also found one of my newest favorite books, and that is People We Meet on Vacation by Emily Henry. I have never read an Emily Henry before, so when I saw that this was a book of the month pick for April, I was ecstatic. In this one, we follow Poppy and Alex, who seem to be polar opposites. Poppy is very out there, straightforward, very just adventurous. She's always doing and saying what she wants. And then we have Alex, who is more poised, more chill, more toned down. He kind of grounds Poppy in the areas where she can't ground herself. And they have been going on vacations together ever since they met. They have the most fun summers together, even if they are in the most unlikely places, in the most unlikely scenarios. One summer, they actually fell out of their friendship, and now Poppy, very regretful of the place where they're at with their friendship, reaches out to Alex again and wonders if they can go on this one last vacation to see if they can potentially save their broken friendship and maybe even confess their love for each other, because Poppy has been pining for Alex ever since she met him. I very rarely read friends to lover romance, and so when I saw the premise for this book, I was really intrigued to see how that was gonna go down. I really have found that I like the pining trope when it is done correctly, and I really enjoyed how this took place in here. You can see that even if Poppy and Alex are vastly different in personalities, they still complement each other so much, and I think they truly embody the why date somebody who's so similar to you. If you are different, then you got, you know, the banter and just the tension and the chemistry, and it is all there, and that is definitely what Poppy and Alex are. I just love that they have so much history into their past, and not only that, but Emily Henry also managed to capture so much beyond what their friendship is, and a lot of familial dynamics and personal inner struggles that need to be overcome in order to be with someone. At the end of the day, I think this book really talks about how you can't fix someone if they don't want to be fixed, if they don't want to be better themselves, and so that journey starts from within. You have to start that yourself. It alternates between present time and the past when they were still going on these vacations together, kind of building up to the point where we as a reader find out why they fell out of this friendship. I pictured Alex as Chris Evans Evans because he was like the teacher who was really hot and just very built and strong and fit, but he always wore khakis and button-up shirts. I was just like, Steve Rogers is who Alex is. I just had a great time reading this. 5 out of 5 stars, no doubt. The next one is The Off-Limits Rule by Sarah Adams. I don't currently have this book with me because one of my best friends is currently reading it. However, I thought I was really gonna enjoy this book, and then I'm not gonna say that I hated it because I didn't, but I definitely didn't enjoy it as much as I could have. Now, in this one, we follow Lucy, who is a single mom, and she is currently bankrupt, so she has to move back home. She has to move in with her brother, her older brother, alongside her kid, and in the midst of that, she meets his brother's best friend, Cooper, who is off limits. That's the only rule that his brother sets. You cannot date, you cannot be seen together, you are not going to ruin my friendship with my best friend. And then you can guess what happens. I think one of my biggest issues with The Off Limits Rule was that Cooper, as the male love interest, continuously hit Lucy as the she's not like other girls, this pixie manic dream, she is super quirky and she doesn't want to be in the water and she wants to read. And at one point in the book, very early on, he literally says she's not like other girls, like she's so different. And it's like, she's literally a regular human being, like she is a regular girl. And I also kind of had a little bit of a struggle with Lucy as a main character. I found that she was oftentimes really immature, she didn't necessarily behave very adult-like, very mother-like, and so I didn't necessarily vibe with these two characters separately. So when you bring them together, I also didn't vibe with the relationship and the relationship dynamic. I didn't necessarily see the chemistry between these two characters. I don't think I understood as a reader to the point where they said I love you. I didn't understand how we had gotten there. Also, the book is incredibly short. It's like under 300 pages, so that also could have been it, but I definitely had a big struggle reading this. Granted, it's very easy to read. However, I didn't love it, so I ended up giving it a 2-star. And next up, I also read The Bad Beginning by Lemony Snicket. This is one that I audiobooked. I decided to audiobook it because I found out that it had a full cast of characters, full sound effects, and let me tell you, the production for the audiobook was 10 out of 10. The narrator is also Tim Curry. Also, very important to note, I had never read A Series of Unfortunate Events. This is my first time reading this. I didn't grow up reading this. I was very shocked. We follow the Baudelaire siblings after they lose their parents in a fire, and the parents have obviously left behind a big fortune. They were very wealthy, and the kids can't access this fortune up until the bigger sister becomes of age, and that's when she can access all of the money and, you know, have at it in whatever way they please. However, the siblings are appointed to Count Olaf, who is now to take care of them, except that this man turns out to be a little bit more sinister than I even thought possible. Crap goes down. This is a very dark middle grade, y'all. I didn't expect it to be this dark, and I think the fact that I went in completely blind, not knowing what to expect, nobody had warned me that this was gonna be a part of the plot, I found it really disturbing, and I found it really even traumatizing as an adult to read this and kind of reflect back and think, this is middle grade. Kids are reading this. But this man is abusive to these kids. Literally, he is making them cook and run his errands, and he wants to take their fortune and will do so by any means necessary, whether it's by marrying an underage girl, whether that's by killing people. It's just very disturbing, I guess, what this man is willing to do in order to get that money. I mean, granted, the narration for the audiobook was fantastic because I couldn't stop gasping and I couldn't stop looking around me to see if somebody was playing a joke on me with what I was reading, because I was incredibly shocked. But I just don't know if I'd recommend this to middle graders. I don't know about that. Like, I think about this and I go, maybe like middle grade for adults, I can see it. I can't grasp that concept quite yet. I think my brain is still trying to catch up with the fact that this is middle grade. I did give it 3 stars though. Love of my life, I read Heartstopper Volume 3 by Alice Oseman. I just had to get this. I had to read it as soon as I got here, and I definitely did. I also was not expecting all of the themes and conversations that we would get in this one. Now, if you don't know, in this one, we follow Nick and Charlie, who are in the rugby team together. And once they meet, they start developing this friendship, this newfound friendship. And we explore both of these dynamics, this relationship, this friendship, as these two move again from friendship to relationship. And obviously, it talks a lot about not only sexuality, but also coming out in your own terms, presenting yourself to the world in whatever way you want, unapologetically, just being yourself. I love the way that Alice Oseman presents all of these things. And in this this one in particular, we got a lot of traveling, we got a lot of romance, and just a lot of, honestly, tension between Nick and Charlie. I honestly wasn't expecting that to be a part of this volume. We also got a lot of talk about eating disorders, which was also not something that I was expecting. So that is, I guess, a content warning before you go into this one. A lot of themes that were from the other books kind of rolled over onto this one as well. Themes of depression and bullying, and again, eating disorders. Just feel for both of these characters so much because they want to be there for each other as best as they can, but sometimes circumstances don't allow them to be. And so I'm definitely rooting for them. I absolutely loved this one, gave it 4 stars, and I can't wait for volume 4 to get here because it comes out this month. I am just so excited to get into it too. I found a new favorite book in April, and that is The Beautiful by Renee Adier. I was scared going into this because I knew a lot of people had gone into this book, had rated it 2 stars, 3 stars, so I didn't really know what to expect. The only thing that I knew to expect going into this was that the fantasy supernatural element was going to be very low key. It wasn't going to be yelled at from the rooftop as you would see in other supernatural, paranormal, or fantasy books. And so because I guess I was so prepared going into this and knew what to expect, I think that honestly made my reading experience so good. In this one, we follow Celine as she arrives to New Orleans from France. She is a dressmaker and she finds herself in the midst of a long-going feud with the creatures of night and a serial killer that is on the loose who now has his sights set on her. And we have witches and vampires and again, supernatural creatures in this book, but nothing is blatantly told to you like, this person's a vampire or this person's a witch. You never really know that, but you can deduct all of that based on the way that they act and the actions that they are committing. So I love the fact that it's more low key and that it does give the reader a little bit of credit to find out who these characters are, what part they're playing into this story. The atmosphere in this was fantastic. I think the ambiance of New Orleans is something that I very much enjoy. I have found out the Originals vibes all the way. You guys know me. And I just loved the dynamic between Sebastian and Celine, and the tension between these two characters was so palpable. Whenever they were in a room together, you can tell that they gravitate towards each other so much, even though they shouldn't. And I just absolutely love that. The intrigue levels in this book were also at a literally mile high. I was enthralled for the entirety of the read. I read this in one sitting. That's how good this book was. I just loved everything about this. Gave it 4.5 stars. Can't wait to go into the next one. Just fantastic. And for my April Patreon book club picks, I read The Mystery of Black Hole Lane by Julia Noble, and I didn't love this as much as I thought I would. And that was just, I had a whole discussion live stream with my Patreons talking about it, where we can gush about the book and just, again, spill all of our thoughts. And it was very interesting because I was one of the few ones that didn't end up loving The Mystery of Black Hole Lane. This is said to be dark academia middle grade, and it definitely was. I just think I have been conditioned to think about the dark side of dark academia and how twisty and just disturbing it is, because when you read dark academia in adult, it's very just triggering and crazy. And I don't know what I was expecting from a middle grade, but I guess this is what you would get from a middle grade dark academia, because it can't be that dark, can it? So in this one, we follow Emmy, whose father has disappeared long ago, and she lives with her mother. Her mother is a psychologist and she has a lot of things going on at once. She is a writer, she has a reality TV now, and so because of all of those things and because she's so busy, she ships Emmy to a boarding school in the UK called Wellsworth Academy. And in there, she starts seeing these signs that relate back to some medallions that she found in her father's attic. And so she now has figured out that that is somehow connected to her father. Her father is somehow connected to the academy. She just doesn't understand how or why, and she will go deep into this issue alongside her friends Jack and Lola to try and figure out exactly what happened to her father and exactly how he was connected to this school and the secret society called the Order of Black Hollow Lane. So I think my letdown was the characters. The characters in here felt very shallow to me. They didn't feel very fleshed out. I thought everything was very unsurface level. It didn't really delve deep into the characters or their backstories. I didn't really understand where they came from, except for, I guess, a little bit of Emmy and Jack, but everybody else, it was, again, very surface level. People being mean for the sake of being mean, it felt like, and I just didn't necessarily love that. I also didn't necessarily love the twist in this. I guess I had a lot of expectations going into this that weren't met. So it was very much a personal thing of, this is what I made the book out to be, and it wasn't that. So in my head, it turned out to be a disappointment. However, the audiobook for this is really good. It's really short. It's like 5 hours long. Ended up giving it a 2-star. didn't love it, but it is what it is sometimes. Another book and series potentially that could also potentially become one of my brand series here on my channel, A Discovery of Witches by Deborah Harkness. I preface this by saying I gave this 5 stars. 5 well-earned, no doubt stars. Now, I will warn you though, if you're interested in going into this, know that this is very dense. There's a lot of information in here about alchemy, science, history, DNA, alchemical marriages. There's just so much in here. That's why it took me a little bit longer to get through it, but honestly, I wouldn't have wanted it any other way. I enjoyed this so much, finished it, watched the entirety of season 1. I need to go into book 2. When is it gonna be here? Still waiting for my packets to get here. And in this one, we follow Diana, who is a witch, but she has been neglecting witchcraft for the entirety of her life. She refuses to admit and recognize that she is a well-bred witch, and she is a scholar at Oxford University. And one day, browsing the Oxford Bodleian Library, she finds an alchemical text called the Ashmole 72. And when she takes this out of its shelf spot, she basically starts a war between species. And so she teams up with Matthew Claremont, who is a vampire, and a romance starts developing between these two, even though it is forbidden. And on top of that, they need to figure out, against the clock, why people want this alchemical text, why it's so important, why everybody's against them, and why everybody wants Diana dead. Characters 100. Matthew, Isabel, Martha, all of them were so fantastic. Also, Matthew Good as Matthew Claremont on the show. Perfect freaking casting. The acting is literally top tier. I can't stop saying enough good things about this. I love the world that Deborah Harkness put in here. I also love the fact that Deborah Harkness is a historian herself, meaning that she brings in a lot of historical elements that are true, but she warps them in a way to fit this fantasy supernatural setting, and it works. I typically wouldn't read books that are so dense with real life information, with stuff about science and alchemy. I don't care about that. I don't like that. It works here. And I found myself shocked oftentimes reading this and being so interested in what was going on. The chemistry between Diana and Matthew was, again, just top tier. Love every single bit of it. I love that smut, or, you know, just the typical sex that you'd see in like paranormal supernatural stories, wasn't in here. It wasn't the focal point of this. It was more so about their bond, about their intellect, about them figuring out where exactly they fit in this war. It was just so fantastic. It was just, oh, 5 out of 5 stars. I cannot wait to go into book 2. We are now getting into the 24-hour readathon territory. Again, my vlog is not up yet, but it will be up soon enough. I read Horrid by Katrina Leno. Probably should have listened to my friends when they told me that Katrina Leno was not gonna be it. I didn't listen though, and I read this and I gave it, unfortunately, 1 star. In this one, we follow a mother-daughter duo as they move from California to a dreary town in Maine, to their childhood home. And in there, a lot of strange things start happening. There is a room that has said to be empty for years on end, except that it seems to be an inhabited by a little girl. It seems to be a little girl's room, and nobody seems to understand why or how. I think my issue with this book is that it felt like a script. Oftentimes, there wasn't enough description for the tension to feel real for me. I think it's a personal pet peeve of mine that if you're writing horror or a thriller, there better be enough description in here that when those tense parts are going down, that I feel exactly what the character is feeling, that I feel kind of the walls closing in on me, and I feel the need to figure out what is happening, that I feel the need to even close the book because it's freaking me out. That's the feeling that I wanted from this book based on the premise, even based on what happened, and that is not how I felt at all. It was very jumpy as well. The transition between scenes didn't feel very natural. It literally felt as if this one thing happened, and then this one thing happened, and then that thing happened, and we just need to accept it as a reader. It was also very unrealistic, in my opinion, that the main character literally gets to this town and she is suddenly friends with everybody on day one and gets a job at day one and has her life figured out at day one. It just felt all over the place for me, and so I didn't enjoy this. Then I read Allegedly by Tiffany D. Jackson. Now, this one I also read during the readathon. So the premise of this is Mary B. Addison killed a baby. Allegedly. We follow Mary as she is currently imprisoned, again, wrongfully imprisoned, for the death of this child that her mother and and her were taken care of one night. So right off the bat, when this book starts, it just shocked the hell out of me. I was like, damn, okay, so this is what we're doing. I like it. I love it. And this really addresses the conversation about wrongful conviction and kind of what it is like to live life imprisoned for something that, again, you didn't commit, and the dynamic between prison mates and being hopeful for something beyond it. And I think that's what I liked so much about Mary, was that even as a main character, even if everything seemed so hopeless for her, she still had so much motivation to keep propelling herself forward, to keep learning more, to get out of this hole that she has literally been thrown into. And so I like the motivation of the character. I like the fact that she was so driven and that she was so passionate about the things that she wanted and the things that she wanted to pursue. I think where I draw and I come at a standstill a little bit is the ending of the book. The ending to me felt very disconnected with the sequence of events that we had gotten before. I didn't feel like it felt realistic or natural. I ended up giving this book a 4-star based on Copile. I think I'm gonna keep it at a 4-star because honestly, I feel like the one thing that I didn't love about this book was the ending, but everything else when I look back at it was really good. The audiobook for this is also really fantastic. I started reading this physically for like the first 100 pages, and because I felt very tired and I didn't want to read with my eyes during the readathon, I switched to the audio. Another readathon book is Pages & Co. 2, Tilly and the Lost Fairy Tales. I'm so sad that I didn't enjoy this as much as I thought I would. I had such high expectations, especially after book one, because I adored book one. It was so wholesome. I love Tilly and Oscar and their journey. I will say though, this one was very interesting. I liked the expansion into the world and how fairy tales are very unreliable as far as book wandering goes. I love the fact that because every single fairy tale is different and they have been told down from generation to generation, that's why they're so unreliable. So the world expansion on this one, I really loved. I think there were parts of it that I was just very bored at. There were a lot of twists and turns on the first one that were so great and really, again, elevated my expectation for what was to come. So when the twists and turns on this one didn't feel nearly as exciting as book one, I couldn't get behind it. So ended up giving it a 3.5. Then we have A Fall Love Story. Now that I think about it, I really audiobooked a lot of books this month. Anyway, point is, I also audiobooked the entirety of A Fall Love Story. The audiobook is literally incredible. Has two narrators going for both of the main characters, Bao and Lin. The audiobook really had me in it, y'all. So in this one, we follow Bao and Lin, who are in high school together, but their families have feuding, competing pho restaurants, and they kind of have been pining for each other for a while. They kind of really are into each other, and a chance encounter really brings them together with sparks flying, and they need to figure out exactly the truth behind their parents' feud, between their families' feuds, I should say, and why it's so strong and what is preventing them from being together, if that is the decision that they want to take. I think oh my god, you guys know that I love contemporaries that, yes, are romances, but that, yes, also have a lot of real life issues, situations. The culture in here shines so bright. The food, just anything regarding Vietnamese culture was so strong in here that I found myself just really in awe of how good it was. Again, the food description, the references, there was a lot of Vietnamese as well in this book. So I will say audiobooking it was really fantastic to see the pronunciation of a lot of these things. And beyond that, obviously it has a lot of familial dynamics, which you guys know that I adore. And truly the familial dynamic in here was very complicated because not only are you dealing with parents who have great expectations for their kids, but you're also dealing with immigrant parents who had to go through so many things, the Saigon conflict and literally coming to America in a boat. So interesting to me how this book addresses all of those topics, all of those issues, and highlights them in a way where not only is it enjoyable, but also educational for the reader who doesn't necessarily know any of these things. It sheds some light on that experience that is so unique. And so I really just adored A Fall Love Story. The audiobook again was fantastic. Bao and Lin literally have my entire heart. I love how passionate they were about their respective fields and what they wanted to pursue, and how even if all odds were against not only them as a couple, but them professionally after school, I love how they were so resilient. And I mean, obviously that speaks to how their parents raised them in, you know, a situation that is seemingly all odds against them. I just really love the motivation of these characters and just how willing they were to chase after their dreams. And it was just 4.5. 4.5. Incredible. My other Patreon book club for April was Stalking Jack the Ripper, and this one I gave 4 stars. This one was so good. I find that this one is really interesting. I had read Kingdom of the Wicked before this one, and the writing is so different from Kingdom of the Wicked. Gary Maniscalco is a master at writing sensory details. I often found myself disgusted with the description that they had about literally pulling apart a corpse and pulling out organs. It was very descriptive, it was very nasty, but I found myself really enjoying it. It was very dark in tone. I really liked Audrey as a main character. She has a backbone. She is not afraid to stand up for herself, and I love everything about that. My main issue with this book was Thomas, who is the male protagonist love interest. I found him very annoying, cocky, entitled. A lot of backhanded compliments from him to Audrey that I didn't necessarily love, but also very much reminded me of Sherlock Holmes and Fred, like Freddie Prinze Jr.'s Fred from Scooby-Doo is what he reminded me of. You know, the person who thinks that they know everything, but they don't really, but it has the cockiness of Sherlock Holmes, kind of like all of that wrapped into one. But I really did enjoy this. I think I really enjoyed the way that Cary Maniscalco put the foreshadowing and red herrings in here. I think it was very engaging for the reader. I was playing detective for the majority of this book, and I was right. So it was really good. I can't wait to jump into the next one, because I really do feel like the next few books is when we'll start seeing the character development. So I gave this one 4 stars. And last but not least, I read Gemina. Gemina was a surprise. The only reason why I read this, truthfully, after the whole J. Kristoff thing went down, the only reason why I read this was because it was on my TBR. Otherwise, literally wouldn't have read this after everything that went down on Twitter, everything that came to light about the anti-Semitism and the racism and the cultural appropriation. This book was just such a letdown. I didn't care about anything. I didn't care about the characters, about the love interest, about the romance, about the conflict, about the world. Absolutely nothing. The audiobook was not nearly as good as book one either, which was a shame. I really had my main issue was the romance in here. The romance felt very creepy. I just didn't like the way that he was going about the flirting and how everything was over-sexualized in this book. I really had an issue with how, again, the male love interest sexualized everything that the girl did. It was unbelievable. I felt really uncomfortable listening to the audiobook, where I often found myself going, this is not what I signed up for. And beyond that, the conflict in this, again, was not nearly as interesting. I think the elements that I really enjoyed about book one, primarily, like, they weren't even here. So, like, I didn't really care about the conflict in the slightest, and don't vibe with it at all. So I gave it 1 star, and I'm not even mad about it. So yes, you guys, those are all of the books that I read in the month of April. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, give it a thumbs up. Let me know down below what books you read in April. Were there any favorite books that you found in the month? Let me know all of that down in the comment section, because I'm always peeping that, responding to you guys, writing down your recommendations, always doing that every single month. If you reach the end of the video, let's leave a palm tree emoji for people we meet on vacation, because that was definitely the best book in, like, my opinion that I really, really love that I read in April. So let's leave some palm tree emojis if you reach the end of the video. Don't forget to subscribe down below if you haven't already for more bookish content, constantly uploading videos that I'm sure you don't want to miss. I am also live streaming every Friday, doing weekly reading sprints. And if you want more exclusive access to me, Buddy Reads, a Discord server, if you want more live streams, extra videos, everything in between, the link to my Patreon is down below, so you can sign up for that. We call ourselves the Citadel, and it's always a fun time. Alongside that, you can also find all of the links to my social media. Thank you again to Chirp Audiobooks for sponsoring today's video. Don't forget that you can use the code MelReads50 to get 50% off your first order. The link for that is down below as well. And yeah, I love you guys so much, and I shall see you on the next one. Bye, guys.